I thank Professor Rohit to include me as a part of his instruction course. So I think we've a lot of tackling esotopias. A lot of this has actually been discussed in some form or the other. So I'm going to very quickly try and run through it, and hopefully show you a few cases that will give us a sense of how we're actually practically going about managing esotropia. So I'll go through a few steps. The first step, and probably the step zero, is of course the vision and the refraction. So that a cyclopegic refraction, which is already discussed. But a step one would be to look at the head posture, because this is when you want to see the kid, even before the kid realizes that you're observing him. So that's important. You have to look for if there's a chin up or down, if there's a tilt, if there is a turn. So you need to look for the first step is to look for a head posture. The second step after looking for the head posture is to do a cover test. So to rule out, pseudo versus true esotropia. So if there's a movement on the cover test, these are all pseudoisotropes because of the wide or the telecanthic appearance of the tissues here. And also you need to see whether it's freely alternating or not, because you need to know, is it a child who's not alternating likely has a poor vision in one of the eyes or an amblyopia, and that may require treatment first. After this, you need to look at the ocular movements, and this is in the sense of what the complete excursions are, whether there's any nystagmus or not, any oblique overactions, any patterns that you're seeing. Here you can see this is an inferior oblique overaction. There was an S2 underaction, which I've not shown here. And you can see that this is a case of a Duane's where there is an abduction limitation. So that's the next step. And probably the step right after that is then to look at what's happening, what change is happening with the glasses or with the refraction, and also to look at the AC by A ratio, which is to look at the accommodative conversions by accommodative ratio. So you'll see that there are various forms of esotropia which gets corrected with glasses. Some of them would require probably bifocals, some of them would require unifocals, so they could belong into an accommodative category, and we'll come to the classification briefly, or they could be non-refractive esotropias, or they could be partially accommodative, where they improve somewhat with glasses, but then require surgery to correct the lest, as you can see in this girl here. So even after surgery without glasses, there still is a bit of a eso. So you have to give glasses after that. So idea is to kind of somewhere or the other classify esotropias. Do they fall in this category or this category? And the commonest esotropias that we generally tend to see, or the infantile esotropias, are actually not dependent on, are they non-accommodative, right? So they may have glasses, and you have to give the full cycloplegic correction, but for the deviation for distance and near would be same. So they're basic form of esotropias. Then you also need to look at incompetent ones, whether they're paralytic or restrictive. So let's look at one case. So we get this young kid, about 8 months old, who presents with an esotropia on one of the eyes. We do a cover test. We confirm that's a true esotropia. We do a refraction. We realize that there was only about a plus one or plus 0.5 or plus one that was given, but made no difference to the squint. And because we do expect that at this age, that would be the normal refraction for a child. So in such a situation, we'll come to what has to be done. And often you'll have to get into a surgical management. So the first thing, of course, is an atropine refraction. Of course, had there been amblyopia, which he was alternating freely, we would have done an occlusion therapy first and followed by the surgical management. So when do you need to operate? And see, after surgery, they become quite straight. I think any time after about 6 months of age, that's as early as you can kind of do. The youngest I've operated is about probably 6 or 7 months. But any time, this 4 to 6 months to a year is a good time to operate. There are normograms which are available in terms of the surgeries to be done, and over time you realize your own outcomes. And I think Dr. Ankur will discuss more on the decision making in squint surgeries here. So I'm going to just leave it at saying that the idea is that infantile esotropias in this kind of a case would require surgery. This was a patient who was sent in to me from Kenya with a squint, and they were expecting a surgery. When we did a refraction, proper refraction, we saw that the glasses corrected everything. The parents were happy and disappointed both, because they'd flown in all the way just to get a power. But sometimes, had they done a proper atropine refraction there, it would have done great wonders. And mind you, when we did a refraction which was done previously not with atropine here, there was no correction, because some of these dark pigmented irides actually require a very strong cycloplegia. So that's what we were able to get. So this is a form where just giving refractive correction alone would do it. And the surgery would only be done, if at all, in case of a partially accommodative, where not for the dynamic, but for the static component, or the component which persists after giving the glasses. That would be a case like this. So here we see this boy who's having an esotropia here, which is increasing for near when he's fixating on the camera target that we've given him. When we give glasses here, he does improve. With bifocals, there is an improvement, but still a small amount of esotropia is left, and he's not very comfortable with the bifocals that's there. So we could have actually kind of left him on with bifocals there, but here for a reason we had to do a surgery because he was not accepting them at all, and the eso was causing a problem with the stereo acuity. But in a situation like this, you could either leave them there, but if a leave them with bifocal glasses. But if an esotropia persists, then you need to think in terms of surgery, because that goes into a partially accommodative variety. So this is one case that I'm showing, and probably the last case is one here, which is partially accommodative. So a girl with esotropia given glasses still persisting is an indication for surgery for the amount of esotropia that is left after giving the glasses, after a full cycloplegic correction. So that's what we did. An esotropia, glasses, required surgery, but you see, even after surgery, without the glasses, the esotropia is there, and it's only with glasses and surgery together that there's a full correction achieved. So this is roughly four common cases that you'd probably come across in children that I've discussed, and I think for the want of time, there are, the others would be discussed, you know, in other courses, I'm sure.